presents I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to a brand new series of I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, coming to you from the Theatre Royal in Brighton. We're here as part of the Brighton Festival, the country's premier festival of the arts, whose reputation for staging pioneering and original entertainment of the very highest quality has been built up painstakingly over many years. What a shame to blow it all with one. Speaking personally, I'm delighted to be here. Having spent a very pleasant afternoon looking at antiques, I'm in the perfect mood to settle back and listen to some. Let me introduce them to you now. They are on my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And please give a warm welcome to a young woman who can't wait to do a bit of scoring, the delightful Samantha. Incidentally, Samantha tells me she's off after the show to meet a nice gentleman for an Italian meal. She's looking forward to some spaghetti, perhaps a little ravioli, and no doubt a large portion of gnocchi. Now, our first round is entitled Celebrity Answer Phones, and this has nothing to do with answer phones that happen to be celebrities in their own right. It means, teams, that I'd like you to suggest some messages that celebrities might leave on their telephone answering machines. For example, for Tim here, it might be, "Hello, this is Tim Brooke Taylor. I'm not here at the moment, but whatever it is, I'll do it."
Oh, you bitch.
Okay, have you got... Right. Barry, will you start us off, please?
Well, they are celebrities now. Anglican vicars who deny the existence of God have a standard answer machine now that says, "I don't believe I'm in."
A historical one for you. "Hello, this is Dr. Jekyll here. I'm not in at the moment." "Hi, dear, I'm in." "If you come round, I'll give you one. If you don't mind, most faithfully, just waiting and..." "Oh, after the deep."
Yeah. Graham.
Yes, there's one here. "Hello, Peter Tatchell is out." "If you'd like to be out too, please leave your name and diocese."
"Captain Oates. Hello, I've gone out. I may be some time, so don't bother to leave a message."
Beep.
"Hello, Bertrand Russell here. I'm not here at the moment, and yet perhaps I am in a very real sense. Like the page... like the page of a book before you've turned it over. Is it printed? Is it blank? So I may well be here, but why are we here? Particularly when we're not." Beep.
"Hello, John Major is in at the moment, but only by the skin of his teeth." If you'd like to leave a message, please speak after the moan." "Hello, this is Alexander Graham Bell, inventor of the first telephone. If you have invented another telephone..."
We're going to play now a rather complicated game called One Song to the Tune of Another, which may need some explanation. In it, teams, we take a song or tune and remove the lyrics or words from the tune or song, and then, and this explains why we call it One Song to the Tune of Another, we take the lyrics or words away from another tune or song and get you to sing the words with the tune from the first song without the lyrics but with the music. And if this were not challenge enough, teams, accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell at the piano. Incidentally, we've just heard some great news. I'm very pleased to announce that the BBC have arranged a special collection of Colin's entire work. They bagged it up and the council are sending some men round for it on Tuesday. Right, Tim, I'd like you to sing the words of My Old Man's a Dustman to the tune of Morning Has Broken.
My old man's a dustman. He wears a dustman's hat. He wears corblimey trousers, and he lives in a council flat. He looks a proper nana in his great big hobnail boots. He's got such a job to pull him up that he calls them Daisy Roots.
Okay, your turn, Barry. I'd like you to sing the words of The Sun Has Got His Hat On to the tune of Scarborough Fair.
The sun has got his hat on, hip, 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 hooray. The sun has got his hat on, and he's coming out today. Now we'll all be happy, hip, 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 hooray. The sun has got his hat on, he's coming out today. He's been tanning tourists out in Timbuktu. Now he's coming back to do the same to you. Jump into your sunbath, hip, 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 hooray. The sun has got his hat on, and he's coming out today.
Right, it's you now, Willie. Would you sing the words of Old MacDonald Had a Farm to the tune of New York, New York?
Yes, but not well. Old MacDonald had a farm, E-I-E. I went on this farm, he had some chicks, E-I-O with a chick, chick here and a chick, chick there. Here a chick, chick there, a chick everywhere. Here you go.
And finally, what a lovely word that is, finally. Graham, would you sing the words of Space Oddity to the tune of English Country Garden?
Ground control to Major Tom, ground control to Major Tom. Take your protein pills and put your helmet on. Control to Major Tom, commencing countdowns, engines on, check ignition, and may God's love be with you. This is ground control to Major Tom.
Well, now it's time to play a brand new game called Name That Barcode. Anyone who regularly visits our modern supermarkets will know the barcode as an ingenious device for identifying the individual price of a product. The item is picked up by the cashier, who simply runs it past an electronic reader three or four times before holding it up and calling out, "How much is this?" At which point, the price appears as if by magic in no more than 10 or 15 minutes. Now, teams, I've taken the liberty of bringing along some of my favourite barcodes, and I'd like you please to identify them. And here's the first one. Thick black, thin white, thin black, thick white. Thick black, thin white, thick black, thick white, thick black, thin white, and thick black. Okay, who's going to identify that?
I know this one. I'm not sure how. It's Lilettes with wings. I think. Just one of those things you remember as you see it.
Well, you remembered it wrong.
Oh.
Sour cream.
And why does Sainsbury's put a sell-by date on sour cream?
Do they come in ones or threes, these?
What? No, none of you have got anywhere near it.
Cotton buds.
No.
I use them nasally.
No, it's an oven-ready badger, £2.99. Well, let's try another one. We'll try another one. Thick white, thin black, thick white, thin... Thin black, thick white, thin black, thick white, thick white, thick white, and thin black.
This is a cheat. This is a special offer, isn't it?
No, I think you've got it. It was thick white, thick white, thick white. Three thick whites at the end.
Well, thick white, thick white, thick white, thin white. Rolling Stones.
Now, I'm going to give Tim a mark for that, because he got nearest, it wasn't very near, in suggesting that it was a special offer. It's the Colin Sell Piano Tutor. Remaindered. It's now time for another thoroughly enjoyable game called Cheddar Gorge, which is just one of many traditional pastimes taking their title from English place names. For example, there's Chipping Norton, which involves making stone sculptures in the shape of motorcycles. Then we have Tower Bridge, a card game for exceptionally tall players. And I understand there are still certain isolated rural communities in Lancashire that like to play Upper Ramsbottom.
Dear, oh dear.
Anyway, as the game Cheddar Gorge so obviously implies, teams, I'd like you each to utter a single word in turn. The object of the game is to avoid completing a sentence. To complicate matters further, however, I'd like you each to include a word of my choosing, and these are, for you, Tim, defenestrated. Graham, briefs.
Brief.
Barry,
Yes?
Got that, Barry?
Yes. By installments.
Barry, existentialist.
Oh, right.
And Willie, Pong. Now, teams, when you hear this...
Like.
When you hear this, teams, it either means someone's playing under the 1972 rules or I've decided the sentence is complete. Right, Tim, will you start, please?
I
was
in
a
very
existentialist
condition when I
saw
coming towards me
a
Pong. So I
immediately
ran
away
from
the
Pong. Pausing shortly
to
Pong. With
a
small
pong.
It's a medley of pongs.
I like this game. I must be scoring an enormous number.
This is a pong for Europe.
Yeah, exactly.
Full stop.
Don't look at me.
You just ended the sentence. Our next round is entitled Builder's Jargon. In it, I'll be asking the teams to provide some examples of words or phrases used habitually by builders, together with what they actually mean. And just to get themselves in the mood, the teams have each drunk 2 gallons of sweet milky tea, eaten a packet of chocolate hobnobs each, lowered their jeans to reveal the mandatory 1¼ inches of cleavage, and laid around all day doing nothing except listen to Radio 1. Right, Willie, will you start us off, please?
Oh, we do electrics means no, we don't.
Graham.
Pebble dash means throw a stone through the window and run off.
Don't use the phone for the moment. We're working on that wall means we've knackered the cable.
I'll be round first thing in the morning. I'll be round tomorrow afternoon just when you decided not to stay in any longer.
Oh, we do plumbing. No, we don't.
That door won't stick when the wood's dried out means that door won't open when the wood's dried out.
You know what they say about dust? It's lucky.
Oh, we do tiling.
No, that is level. You're leaning.
You won't know we're here means we won't be here.
Right. Well, with the score mounting apace, it's time for the next round, which is called Sound Charades. This round is based on the popular parlour game in which each team takes it in turn to act out the title of a book, film, play or TV programme for the other team to guess. But, as Chubby Checker would say, there's a twist. How did Chubby Checker get in here?
His name was based on Fats Domino. Did you know that? Fats, Chubby, Domino, Checkers.
To return to the rules of this game...
What ever happened to Podgy Chess, I wonder?
Now, in this version of charades, the teams are permitted the use of their mouths in a process technically known as speaking. OK, Tim and Willie, now you're to start, and your title will now be displayed via the megabyte magic of the satellite-linked digitally remastered laser display board, so generously funded by the Brighton Festival. Well, for listeners... For listeners at home, our high-tech Thorpe transmitter will secretly implant the title directly into your heads so that it sounds to you as if it's coming out of the wireless.
My Night with Reg. My Night with Reg.
Right, off you go, Tim and Willie, with your charade.
It's a play, four words.
I saw you leaving with him last evening. What was his name, then?
Do you know, I can't remember. Maudlin? Prentice? Presley?
Varney? It wasn't Varney, was it? It
might have been Varney. What was Elton John called before he was...
Oh, yes, Dwight.
And that was Eisenhower.
Oh.
Is that it?
Yes.
Oh, good. Right.
Do you want to... Yeah, it's My Night with Elton.
Yes.
We don't want to hear about that.
Right, I suppose it's your turn, Barry and Graham, and your title's now going up on the laser display, and here again is the thought transmitter for listeners at home.
Rob Roy. Rob Roy.
Book and a film.
Book and a film.
Book and a film.
Two words.
What are they?
You'll find out shortly.
Yeah. Are you there, Lord Jenkins?
That is true.
Right. Put your hands up. Hand over your wallet.
You rogue, you rascal.
This is a stick-up. Let's have your money and be sharp about it. Blimey, is that all? I don't call that very liberal.
You rotter. The end.
They wanted to say Wob Woy, didn't they?
Oh!
Well, that was fun. Our next round is another new one and has been sent in by Mr. R.F. Preston of Leeds, which he assures me has helped alleviate the tedium of wet camping holidays in Scotland with his wife and thought it might do the same for this programme. He writes, it's called Knights of the Round Table and is based on words starting with the syllable sir, and that's spelled S-I-R-S-U-R or C-E-R. For example, the knight who was prone to running amok, circumstances beyond our control. 1 point to me, Samantha. Or the intriguing knight, surrounded in mystery. Okay, teams, any other...
Would it be possible as an alternative if we could all go on a wet camping holiday in Scotland with his wife?
I booked mine halfway through that last game. Any other suggestions? Teams?
Yes, indeed. I can give you one. The Knight of Rupture, Sir Jekyll Appliance.
And the Knight who likes a pint, Sir Osis of the Liver.
C
Mon on the Mount. That's a night to remember.
Surrealist, the knight with a melted clock for a face.
Musical one, Sir Ree with a fringe on top.
And the rather unpleasant knight, Sir Lee Bastard.
On the other hand, a knight of bliss, Serendipity.
Sir Plus, he was the 12th knight.
The grasping knight, Sir Vice not included.
The electrical knight, Sir Kit Breaker.
The hopes of all the old maids in the court are insurmountable. Some have their eyes on surprise package.
This is a clever one. Oh. Sir Peter Hall. Night at the Opera.
And galloping up is racing Sir Tinty. Oh dear, he's fallen off his horse. Now he's dead, Sir Tinty.
Any more?
No.
Well, after that totally unexpected burst of brilliance, Samantha's been working so hard she's worn my pencil out. But I lent it to her. Our next round is a musical round called Chaz and Dave, in tribute to that fine Cockney songster duo, Flanagan and Allen. Chaz and Dave have over many years become as integral a part of our culture as Cockles and Mussels, Bangers and Mash, Rhubarb and Custard, and Kaolin and Morphine. In this round, teams, I'd like you to sing a well-known song, but in the style of Chaz and Dave. You'll be accompanied, as it were, by Colin Sell, whom I've been informed doesn't know the meaning of the word disharmony. He also seems to struggle with the words stop, that, dreadful, and racket. Right, you're to start, please, Tim and Willie, and your song is the delightful Beatles ballad, Yesterday.
Yesterday, tell me about your troubles.
All my troubles, she's far away.
Look at that.
Now it looks as though they're here to stay.
Blimey.
Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly.
Well, I am suddenly.
I'm a half the man I used to be.
There's
a shadow hanging over me.
Who is that?
Oh, yesterday came suddenly.
Wallop.
Why, she had to go, I don't know, she wouldn't say.
Rabbit.
I said something wrong.
Rabbit.
Yesterday. Today. That was such an easy game to play.
Wallop, Gertrude.
Now I need a place to hide away.
Gertrude.
I believe in yesterday.
Yesterday. Wallop, rabbit, Gertrude.
Very good. Your turn now, Barry and Graham, and your song is the charming I Feel Pretty from West Side Story.
I'm so pretty. I'm so pretty and witty and bright. In a pity, any girl who isn't me tonight. Lovely knockers, London girl, what about the charming? I'm so charming. It's a numbing, a charming, and I feel. It's so pretty. Then I can hardly believe I'm real. Jelly deal. See the pretty girl in the mirror there. Cork. Looking at a tragic will be. Oi, oi. Such a pretty face, such a pretty dress, such a pretty smile. Such a pretty me, pretty boy. I was nothing. And he drives in. Feel like running and does it for joy. Shake a leg, what up? My pretty, wonderful boy.
Pretty boy.
Right, well, that's almost all we've got time for, although there's just long enough, I think, for a quick round of Doctor's Songbook. Teams, I'd like you to please suggest some titles or first lines of songs likely to be popular with the medical profession. And Tim, I'd like you to start.
Knees up, Mother Brown.
Right, well, that's the end of our...
to do that one, which I always thought was Doctor Who's Brown Girl in the Ring, which has show me emotion.
Barry.
Unchained Melody by Urethra Franklin.
I'm too sexy for my truss. Lipstick on your colon. A deeply unpleasant sensation, singing in the brain.
Take the Prozac and don't you come back no more.
Suppositories a jolly good fellow.
Nursum Dorma.
Cold finger.
You're in the money.
Yes, sir, that's my baby.
Rectum, said Fred.
Hernia rose, I bring you.
I want some diagnosis for a blue lady.
Testy's song at twilight.
Oh, I do like to be beside the bedside.
Doctor, no.
They can't take that away from me.
As I... notice the eternal flame of hope has just been put out by the fire officer of destiny. With the sand bucket of fate. It must be the end of the programme. So from the team, Samantha and myself, and the theatre audience in Brighton, goodbye.
Timbrook Taylor, Barry Cryer, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith.
We present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. Piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, where you find us once more in the seaside town of Brighton, a place believed to hold magical powers for rejuvenating the elderly. And if this doesn't work, it's back to the old monkey glands. Anyway, we're broadcasting to you from the town's delightful Theatre Royal, as a light-hearted fixture in the Brighton Festival's calendar of cultural events. You know, it's no easy matter making people laugh. It takes constant practice, a rare natural talent, and a great deal of strain and effort, which is perhaps why our teams so rarely bother. Let's meet them now. They're on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. On my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And finally, keeping a keen eye on the team's points, please welcome the very lovely Samantha. Our first round is entitled Radio Times 2010. The other day, teams, I was listening to an old edition of Tomorrow's World from the 30s when it used to be on the radio. And there was a fresh-voiced announcer by the name of Raymond Baxter. Couldn't have been more than 28. predicting that one day all Wallaces would have moving pictures attached to them and be called televisions. And you know, that set me thinking. What would the Radio Times be like in the year 2010? So, teams, I'd like you please to help me out by suggesting some of the TV and radio programs likely to be listed in such an edition. Barry, will you start, please?
Beadle's still bloody about.
Film 10 with Barry Norman.
Sir Barry Norman, probably by then. It'll be a different world, of course. There'll be a shortage of food. It'll be Michael Aspel with This Is Your Loaf.
I'm sorry I haven't a clue with Humphrey Littleton, Barry Cryer, Graham Garden. And Tim and Samantha Brooke Taylor. Dream on, Tim. Good Morning with Charles and Camilla. And Coco with Frost.
Coronation car park.
Rowan Atkinson and Mr. Has-Been.
The Churchill Lottery live. There'll be pollution everywhere. There'll be the Eurovision smog contest.
The Antiques Roadshow will look at something called a hospital bed.
Anderson Country, the last attempt.
Wimbledon 2010, British hopes rest on Jeremy Bates.
Any more?
No.
Right, well, now it's time for a hilarious round. Oh, sorry, I'll read that again. It's now time for a hilarious round called Pick Up Song. And in it, DJ Samantha will unsleeve a number of choice 12 inches. As well as spinning some discs on my gramophone. The teams should sing along in turn. However, at a certain point, the sound will magically disappear thanks to a complex technique known to electrical engineers as adjusting the volume knob. If on its return, teams, you're within an amoeba's eyebrow of the original, I'll be awarding points, and points mean prizes. What do points mean? If I can do that, what was so special about Hitler? This week's prize is just the thing for the stylish letter writer who regularly uses the M25. It's this personalised stationary vehicle. Right, Graham, I'd like you please to accompany Buddy Holly singing Guess It Doesn't Matter Anymore.
There you go, and baby, here am I. Well, you left me here so I could sit and cry. Well, golly gee, what have you done to me? Well, I guess it doesn't matter anymore. Do you remember, baby, last September, how you held me tight each and every night? Well, whoops-a-daisy, how you drove me crazy, but I guess it doesn't matter anymore. There's no use in me crying. I've done everything and now I'm sick of trying. I've thrown away my nights, wasted all my days over you.
Follow that, Willie.
Going.
Willie, will you... Willie, will you please accompany Edith Piaf singing La Vie en Rose?
Brilliant, brilliant.
Brilliant.
Down in the pond, on the brown, in the pile of two brown, the one of your rosy. Here's the deep old door. Demo de tous les jours, bloody common market. Et ça fait quelque chose. Il est entré dans mon cœur. Il n'y a pas de bonheur dont je connais la cause. C'est lui, pour moi, pas pour lui, dans la vie. Il me l'a dit, la journée, pour la vie.
I was going to get to the point, sir.
That was actually amazing. She must have said bloody common market as well.
Very, very sound judge.
Now, you, Tim, would you accompany the Ink Spot singing Whispering Grass?
Why do you whisper? Rotting soul, whispering grass, the trees don't have to know. No, 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 no. Why tell them all your secrets? Who kissed alone? I don't know the tune. Whispering grass, the trees don't need to know.
Finally, Barry, now this is the best pairing of the lot. Will you accompany Tom Jones singing It's Not Unusual?
It's not unusual to see me cry.
That's embarrassing.
I was. It's not unusual to go out at any time. But when I see you out and about, it's such a crime.
Nancy's out of bed again.
If you just ever want to be loved by anyone, it's not unusual. It happens every day. No matter what you say, find it happens all the time. Love will never do
what you want to do.
If we can have these knickers cleared away, can we? Our next round is for
back.
Order, please.
That takes you back.
Our next round is called Euro I Spy and reflects the ever closer ties we in Britain have with our European neighbours. The British culture team is being lapped up by Euro intellectuals, largely thanks to our unofficial Minister for Heritage, Mr. Henry Kelly, and his marvellous Going for Gold programme. Which would be even more enjoyable and informative were it not for the stumbling attempts at half-broken English made by Henry Kelly himself. Anyway, by way of rebuttal of what is commonly seen as a woeful ignorance on the part of the British of our European partners' mother tongues, I'd like to instigate a game of Euro I Spy, and this is similar to the standard game, the difference being that the object selected should be named in a European language of my choosing. Right, you're going to start, Tim and Willie, and your language is French.
I spy avec mon petit œil with his teeny tiny eye something
quelque chose
beginning with
qui commence avec
elle.
Oh.
La table.
No. No.
La plume.
No.
No.
Show.
La chaise. La chaise of what?
Oh.
I think he means eyelashes.
Ah.
Flutter, flutter.
I've forgotten what it was.
What is it? Did it la?
La macrophone.
Malchance.
Aren't we supposed to get that?
No.
No. Actually, it was that New Zealand film, Le Piano.
Le Piano.
Ah.
Where?
Underneath Colin Sell.
And that's Colin Vendre.
What's happening?
Never mind.
Don't you speak any French at all, Humphrey? Right, it's your turn.
Nul point.
Nul point.
It's your turn.
Hello, Albania.
Marion Graham, your language is Spanish.
Ah, oh, Spanish.
Raspai.
Who is it? My little eye. Something he begin with.
What he begin with?
I'll tell you what he begin with.
Tell you what he begin with.
Well, he begin with hell.
El piano. Lost property. Lost cause. Lost the will to live.
They're getting warm.
El Cid.
Yes, yes.
Yay. In the fourth row. Well, with Graham and Tim racing ahead, our next round is called Hitler's Diary, in which the teams attempt to spot false information. This shouldn't be confused with the old parlor game known as Hitler's Dairy, in which players try to increase their sales of gold top by annexing the Sudetenland. The game was inspired by the Sunday Times' attempt to publish the spurious Hitler diaries. Each team should take turns to read extracts from the private diaries of famous people, either still living or appearing on that show business. The opposing team should buzz if they hear anything that they think might indicate the diary to be a fake. Right, Tim, now I understand that you've managed to unearth some never-before-seen diaries, supposedly written by Margaret Thatcher, and entitled The Post Downing Street Years.
Wednesday the 14th. Geoffrey Howe rang for a chat and we agreed to do another karaoke evening. This time I'm going to be sure.
She's challenged there from Graham Garden.
I don't think she went in for karaoke with Geoffrey Howe. Ping pong, surely, wasn't it?
Afterwards, yes. April the 19th, awake all night worrying about the Belgrano. John Major rang to ask for advice. I said, Jack, the day you need advice is the day I stop breakdancing. Friday, I've asked the servants to burn Dennis and my body after the suicide. I can't bear the thought of being strung up on a lamppost like Mussolini. Or was it George Formby? These diaries must be kept secret. If they are sold, I want all this proceeds to go to that nice Mr. Churchill. Mags.
I didn't want to interrupt that. I was enjoying it, too.
That's enough of me.
It's a good thing, because I didn't have the buzzer switched on. Your turn, Graham, and I understand that your diaries have been ascribed to the man in the iron mask.
Certainly have, Hump. A little extract here. Tuesday, 4th of October. Clean socks.
That itch under my nose is back. As I'm not allowed any sharp implements, such as a knitting needle, I had to try to scratch it by putting a carrot through one of the eye holes.
Perfectly plausible.
Carrot broke off. Now I've got a lump of carrot in here with me.
Challenge there from Tim.
Shouldn't this be in French?
Translating freely as I go.
No, we've had enough French for one
night. Plenty of French.
Go on, Graham.
Well, it could be worse. Bloke in the next cell is the man in the iron underpants. Wonder how Crystal Palace are doing.
Willie, now, if my sources are to be trusted, you've discovered some sort of diaries from the great Mahatma Gandhi.
Mahatma Gandhi. July the 8th. First thing, I went to my spinning wheel and ran up a handsome pale grey loincloth that would set off my very nice new blazer. The question of the day, the big one, is which hairpiece to wear. Lord Mountbatten gave me his nice ginger one for my birthday. And it looks very fine indeed. Mr. Churchill is going to feel the rough edge of my tongue.
And he
July the 9th. I awoke to the delightful sound of my good lady wife, Mrs. Mandy Rice Gandhi, singing Gold's Finger to herself over the kedgeree. I emptied a bottle of chartreuse over my Cocoa Pops and readjusted my toupee. Genuine.
Willie won that round.
Thank you.
Now, it's time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. But first of all, I have to announce the results of our Mornington Crescent Grand Draw in aid of homes for retired comedy gentlefolk and stray llamas. We asked you to complete the following sentence in the most apt or amusing way in no more than 50 words. I like to play Mornington Crescent because... And the winner is a Mrs. Trellis of North Wales, who wrote, I like to play Mornington Crescent because it's quite good. And that was by far the most amusing of the many hundreds of entries we received from Mrs. Trellis. To the game teams, and since we're in Brighton, Regency rules will apply. This means the Nash Convention allows superseding after parallel moves, and all terraces and crescents are wild, unless, of course, you're in Spoon. Right, that all seems to make sense, so Tim, will you start, please?
All crescents, that makes it a bit difficult a while.
I don't care if it's difficult, it's meant to be difficult. You've had it easy for 20-something years now. Now it's beginning to turn the screw.
It does mean, though, we could be here for days.
Yeah. I thought we had. Ah.
Gold Hawk Road.
Birdcage Wall.
Kensington Church Street.
Kensington, right. Hans Crescent.
Vauxhall.
I just heard a crescent whistling through there. Yeah. I don't know whether you were on your toes there, ump.
Yes, but he was
wild.
In Spoon.
That's wild.
Yeah. Oh. Was he in Spoon?
Quite.
He was in Spoon, yes.
Yeah.
I think maybe we ought to explain to listeners at home...
No.
...that Spoon... Spoon, in this sense, is a corruption of Spain. How he got there, I don't know, but Graham was in Spain. Go on, Willie.
Baker Street. Piccadilly.
Island Gardens.
Madeira Drive.
That's not the street, is it? Willie?
I just
Edward Square.
Oh, a brilliant move.
Oh, shut up. Something that dismal. Oh.
Steady on, steady on.
Awful playing with a pessimist square.
Well,
I have to be
no
careful.
Ruling on it, I notice, from a certain quarter.
No Edward ruling on
square.
What?
Square? Well, it's not a crescent, is it?
It's not a crescent square,
it's
isn't
a,
it?
It's not a
crescent.
It's
Isley. Listen, I'm fed up with this. Nothing but nitpicking all the way through the game.
All right, I'll open it out with Regent Street.
Regent Street.
Didn't open it that far, did it?
No, it wasn't exactly.
Wide open, whoopee, here we go.
I think he's trying to lull me into a fool.
Yeah, I think so.
Lower Regent Street.
Mornington Crescent,
yeah. No, no. No.
Yes.
No, it's not Regent Street.
The Nash was invoked. I think that, didn't that go against the Nash Convention?
I thought so.
Yeah,
because he superseded after a parallel move, and the Nash Convention...
Graham was claiming it was the Nash Convention.
Was Nash.
Was
yes.
Nash.
Pure Nash.
Wasn't it?
It was Nash,
well,
wasn't
Nash.
It?
Nash.
Oh, you don't know anything about it.
They know enough to know that he was very deeply, if I might say so, in spoon. Was he not?
I suppose if the audience wants to take over the game, I mean, I don't know what I'm doing here.
Well,
it's been one of those nights. Nothing but arguments and things we've got there.
So did we win or not?
Even Samantha's giving me a hard time tonight. Aren't I a lucky old thing? Who won?
I hope you can.
Right, our next round is... Our next round is entitled, quite simply, Limericks. How many of us, while walking in the garden, taking the train to work, lighting our pipe, or spending £450 in an orgy of instant scratch cards... How many of us have not thought to ourselves, what I'd like to hear is a jaunty comic poem of five lines with the rhyme scheme A-A-B-B-A? Well, now you can. In this round, teams, I'll be providing you with the first line of a limerick, which I'd like you to complete, taking one line each. Barry, you're going to start. Here's your line. While exploring with Captain James Cook...
He gave me an old-fashioned look. He said, hello, sailor. Tell me, who's your tailor?
It must be that nice man, Tim Brook.
Willie, your line is a habit of Vasco da Gama's.
A habit of Vasco da Gama's was to tear off the first mate's pajamas. He'd wave them about and give a great shout.
I wish you were here, Judith Charman.
Graham, here's a line for you. The odd thing about Cecil Rhodes
was his fondness for Natterjack toads.
Pencil.
He'd eat them alive.
Sometimes three, four, or five.
Hence his need for enormous commodes.
Finally, Tim, here's one for you. When out sailing with Sir Francis Drake...
When out sailing with Sir Francis Drake, we discovered Veronica Lake. Younger listeners, pay attention.
We climbed Peggy Mount. Jimmy Hill doesn't count.
Scaling Cliff was a dreadful mistake.
Well, that's just about all we have time for. But before I nip out with Samantha for a time-honored blow on the seafront, I'll just...
Not now.
ask the teams to squeeze in a round of Butcher's Film Club. In this round, teams, I'd like you please to suggest some titles of films likely to be popular with an audience of butchers. Barry, will you start, please?
Beef Encounter. Directed by David Lean.
An awfully big adventure.
Jurassic Pork.
Brawn Free.
The Mince and the Showgirl. Lard of the Flies.
Four Weddings and a Casserole.
Thank you. Reservoir Hot Dogs.
Play it again, Spam.
Oh, Liver.
Rissole Down the Wind.
The Remains of the Day.
Goodbye, Mr. Chipolata.
And so, ladies and gentlemen...
Meet me in St. Louis.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the Ford Anglia of time fails the MOT test of eternity... And the dappled donkey of fate ambles towards the abattoir of destiny. I notice that our time is up. So from Samantha, the teams and myself, and from the good people of Brighton, it's goodbye.
Deborah Taylor, Barry Cryer, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith. We present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello. Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, which this week comes to you from the Palace Theatre in the historic town of Watford. As early as the 9th century BC, the Catalonian king Wilfrid came upon a site by a water crossing where he laid down the foundations of a new city that was to become the envy of the Holy Roman Empire. With its ancient covered market, Romanesque brick towers, Baroque cathedral and fine collection of Renaissance paintings, there are few things finer than to spend the day browsing amidst its remarkable Gothic splendor. A legacy we owe to the vision of that great King Wilfrid of Catalonia. What a pity he never visited Watford. Instead, please welcome on my left Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And on my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And finally, please welcome a delightful lady whose job it is to get the team's points up as fast as possible. Our scorer, Samantha. Our first round is entitled Missed Hits. It's often occurred to me that otherwise first-rate programs, plays, books and films have often sunk without trace for want of a decent title. Teams, I'd like you please to come up with some interesting suggestions for me. And when you've done that, think up some titles that would have been... titles that would have been sure-fire number one smash failures. Tim, would you start, please?
1983. Shallow Gravy.
Barry.
Spot, that's the failed grease.
Willie.
And God created Mrs. Bottomley? Indiana Jones and the Stuffed Panda?
That sounds rather good.
I like it. Graham.
Death date.
Twenty-four hours from Tulse Hill.
Oh, like the Guns of Neasden.
Quite a new one. It is Dumb and Gummer. Killing of Eddie George.
And Dodo Watch. It was their very famous failed song, Trouble Over Bridgewater.
Any more? Famous five get pissed.
I'll go and see that.
Yeah. Now it's time for a musical round in which our teams can exhibit their skill and showmanship to the full by getting their mouths around something unfamiliar. It's a game called One Song to the Tune of Another, in which, as the title might suggest, the teams take it in turns to sing one song to the tune of another. This is not to be confused with the equally popular One Tune to the Song of Another, in which, while another person sings, the teams take it in turns to suck on a mentholated lozenge. To provide the piano accompaniment, here's Colin Sell. Incidentally, Colin tells me he's been commissioned to write a lute concerto. If all goes well, Exchange and Mart might want one as well. Graham, we're going to start with you. Will you please sing the words of Stand By Me to the tune of the Hokey Cokey?
When the night has come and the land is dark and the moon is the only light we'll see, no, I won't be afraid, no, I won't be afraid, just long as you stand by me. Hey! Stand by me. Stand by me, stand by me, stand, stand by me, stand by me.
Jolly good. Now, Barry, will you sing the words of I've Got a Lovely Bunch of Coconuts to the tune of Fly Me to the Moon?
I'm a twist, a flick of the wrist, that's what the showman said. I've got a lovely bunch of coconuts, every ball you throw will make me rich. There's every wife the idol of my life, singing roll a ball a ball, a penny a pitch, singing roll a ball a ball, a penny a pitch, singing roll a ball a ball, a penny a pitch, roll a ball a ball, roll a ball a ball.
Jim, will you please sing the words of On Mother Kelly's Doorstep to the tune of Hernando's Hideaway?
On Mother Kelly's doorstep, down Paradise Row, I'd sit along O Nelly, she'd sit along O Joe. She'd got a little hole in her frock, no lay in her shoe, hole in her sock where her toe peeped through. But Nellie was the smartest down our alley. Olay, on Mother Kelly's doorstep, I'm wondering now if little girl remembers Joe her beau, and does she love me like she used to. On Mother Kelly's doorstep, down Paradise Row. Oh, 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 olay.
And
Funny Willie, will you sing the words of Gloria Gaynor's I Will Survive to the tune of the Blue Danube?
All right, now go, walk out the door. Just turn around now, 'cause you're not welcome anymore. Weren't you the one who tried to hurt me with goodbye, hi, hi? Do you think I'd crumble? Do you think I'd lay down and die? Oh, no, not I. I will survive. Oh, as long as I know how to love, I know I'll...
Our next round is based on the TV program called Through the Keyhole, but modified to make it suitable for wireless transmission. In our game, the teams will enter the homes of well-known people and give clues as to their identity to both entertain and inform the audience. But that's not the only way it differs from the original. We're playing the historical version of the game, where the homes belong to famous people from the past. Backstage, the Palace Theatre have specially modified two mystery cubicles to resemble precisely the homes of certain historical personalities. And the team should take it in turn to describe the contents of their cubicle for the other team to guess. Right, Tim and Willie, you're going to go first, and I'd like you to enter your mystery cubicle now. Take care to knock first, as the lock's broken and there might be somebody in there already. While you're on your way, the historical householder's name will now be flashed up on the computer-linked, satellite-controlled laser display board for the benefit of our... Well, here's the mystery voice for listeners at home.
King Henry VIII. King Henry VIII.
Okay, Tim and Willie, have you entered your cubicle yet?
Yes.
Will you start describing what you see?
Well... Here we are, in the great hall, the umbrella stand full of elephant's feet and tennis rackets.
Are there many suits of armor, some with enormous coat pieces?
And climbing the stairs, now we see great stag's heads, 8 boar's heads, 2 moose heads, and could those be the Nolan sisters?
Enter the bedroom, and we see a fine half-timbered bed, heavily reinforced. Who lives here? Is it a womanizing tennis pro like Martina Navratilova?
Over to you, David.
Humph, the name. Right, Barry and Graham, would you like to start guessing now?
Is this tennis in the sense of real tennis?
No.
Yes.
Then I've no idea. A half-timbered bed, is this a Tudor?
Yes, sir.
Hurry up, it's cold in here.
Should tell the audience you can applaud if they're getting warm.
Henry VIII.
It's your turn, Barry and Graham, to leave the room. Thank God. Would you please enter your mystery cubicle now? And here again is the laser display board with the answer and the mystery voice for listeners at home.
King Ethelred, the Unready. King Ethelred, the Unready.
Hello?
Hello, are you there?
Yeah. Right mess it is, too.
Tim and Willie, you've got to be ready to guess. Okay, carry on.
He must have forgotten we were coming, I think. Obviously left in a hurry. Yes. Oh, look, he forgot to wind up his alarm clock that he slept in. Yeah. One shot, one shoe. Oh, dear. Shopping list he's left behind here. Well, he'll miss that when he gets to Tesco, won't he? Here's his fridge. Look, he's run out of milk, of course. Yeah. And what's this note on the front of it? Collect crown from cleaners. Yeah.
Tim and Willie, start guessing.
It's either Jimmy Nail...
Or Quentin Crisp on one leg. There is a one-leggedness here.
Yes.
Leg is a bit misleading, I think.
So he left in a hurry. So he's a mess. He rushed out. And
and he's royal.
Is he royal?
Yes. Yes.
Was he king? Can we ask that?
Yes. Yeah.
I don't know what gave me that clue.
You just had to roam through the various kings of England, that's
Willy,
all.
Willy, Harry, Steve,
Harry, Dick, John, Harry, three.
You're Willy, late now.
Earlier.
Yeah.
Oh, Ethel.
Oh, Red. Yeah. Always on the blur in photographs, shouting, wasn't ready.
Sorry.
Yeah. Now, it's time for the next round, which is called Word for Word. In it, team members must take it in turns to say a word that's completely and utterly unconnected from the last. So, for example, if Lloyd Webber is followed by talented, that would be perfectly all right. The opposing team should challenge if they notice a connection. Okay, Willie, will you start, please?
Cupboard.
Tongue.
Booth.
Pliers.
Exit.
Bellows.
Face.
Mausoleum.
Houses.
Challenge from Barry.
We're at home. We keep tongue in the cupboard. I thought I'd better strike quickly while the iron was hot.
We don't need to hear about your private life, though, do we? I'd like to give your cupboard a good tonguing. No.
That was a ludicrous challenge. So will you carry on, Barry?
Tankard.
Survivor.
Wave.
Challenge there from Tim.
I don't survive unless I have a tankard of good ale. I can't remember what the local Watford one is, but if I could, I'd say it. What is it? Benskins. Benskins is a very, very fine drop in a tankard. I can survive on that.
Don't say it too loud, and I may send you some.
Can't be too much for me of the Benskins.
I'm going to overrule that challenge and ask you to carry on, Graham.
Unready.
Challenge from Tim.
Benskins is always ready. And I'm always ready for a Benskins.
Carry on, Graham, please.
Pencil. Lead.
How do you spell lead?
L-E-A-D.
Oh, lead.
Banjo. Pluck. Chicken. Chow mein. Special.
Multiple challenge from Tim.
I buzzed a long time ago and I've forgotten what. I don't think you pressed your little whatever you call it.
Are you blaming the chairman for
certainly not
having duff equipment?
Adjudication, please.
We're going to go on now to a game. It's called Name That Toupee. In which I shall ask team members to identify by touch alone the owners of an assortment of celebrity hair pieces. Incidentally, it should be noted that our teams have few problems in this department. Graham, in particular, has a thick, luxurious thatch. Unfortunately, it's on top of his cottage in Cumbria. Now, team Samantha has carefully secreted the mystery toupees in this carrier bag. So, taking utmost care not to use any other sense than touch alone, I'd like you please, teams, to name that toupee. And we'll start with you, Barry.
Green 34. Oh, no, that's the wrap. Oh, I know this one. Wait a minute, just by touch alone here. This is Charlton Heston's. It's red and parted in the middle.
Uh,
Are you under the impression you were right that time?
Never.
Okay, Graham.
I was ahead in this one still. I don't know. This is feels like... No, I think it's a radio toupee. Am I right?
Yes.
A radio toupee. Jimmy? Do you want Jimmy to you?
Oh, yes.
Hey,
just... So I've got the headphones on.
You're only allowed to touch.
Well, we'll go for Jimmy Young.
Absolutely right.
Yeah.
We right, should have called this, I'm sorry, I haven't the glue.
Tim, what do you think?
Jimmy Young.
It bit me.
Right at the bottom here is Yul Brynner. It's not somebody on, standing on their head, is it? Claire Rayner. Only a guess.
Quite right. This next round is called Sequels, and it's limited only by the power of our team's imaginations. Could be one of the quickest ever. As lovers of the arts will have noticed, it's currently the vogue for modern authors to create sequels to classic pieces of literature from the pens of our great writers. I'd like you please, teams, to suggest some extracts from possible sequels to classic works of literature by new authors. And you're going to start, Willie, and I'd like you to suggest some extracts from a sequel to Moby Dick, as written by Raymond Chandler.
When I came round, I was lying face down on the beach at Santa Barbara. Then I heard a voice. I'm looking for a private dick, she said. I looked up. She was beautiful. Her body shimmered like fish skin. She had lips like Andrew Lloyd Webber and gills like Prince Charles. This wasn't surprising. She was a herring. I'm a dick, I gasped. Moby Dick, too. Is that a gun under your jacket, she said, or you're just pleased to see me? That's Gregory Peck, I said. I haven't been able to shake him off since the end of Moby Dick 1. She laughed like whitebait tap dancing on a bed of wet lettuce. I was in love and several sizes too big for her.
Your turn, Tim, now, and I'd like you please to suggest a sequel to the Book of Exodus as compiled by Wisden.
Wisdom would be looking back over the previous season. The season started quite well with preparations for the overseas trip. The first test was spoilt by bad light and locusts. In the second test, the players were asked to play on through frogs and boils, but finally had to come off after a particular vicious attack of moraine on the beasts. The experiment of extending five-day tests to 40 days and 40 nights demanded by Pharaoh Rupert's Earth and Sky Sports was not a huge success. The county captains declared the experiment with Moses' new rules had been successful, but suggested that the one about adultery should be chiseled out for the next season and replaced with Thou Shalt Not Tamper with the Balls. Moses, once again, was voted man of the match and the season. Manner.
Right, it's you now, Barry. Would you please provide us with some likely extracts from Winnie the Pooh's sequel, as written by Michael Winner?
Well, it's an absolutely natural choice, because I'm known affectionately in the profession as Winnie the Pooh, and... In my film, Pooh Sticks 2, Massacre, Winnie and Trigger, played by Charles Bronson, go to a restaurant and the doorman doesn't recognize them, so they waste it. And they go inside and the manager puts them in a table by the window, which is, of course, social death. And they then gang rape the staff with coffee and mints to follow. Do you want a quote on anything?
Finally, Graham, would you supply us, please, with some extracts from Murray Walker's sequel to A Tale of Two Cities?
It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. Sydney Carton heads for the final straight leading to the guillotine, which you will remember is the controversial new device introduced this season for literally twisting the feet off the aristocrats as they... Correction. I am reminded that it actually cuts the heads off and...
It goes on like this forever.
It's now time for a round entitled Just a Minute. We base it on an old Wireless favourite where panellists talk non-stop nonsense while the others try to butt in. But any questions was a bit of a boring title, so we changed it. In this round, teams, you should attempt to sing a song without repetition, hesitation, repetition, roar, pingy, or deviation. Non-singers may buzz to challenge. Please bear in mind, teams, that an excessive number of buzzes may drown out the piano accompaniment of Colin Sell. Actually, Colin was telling me before the show that he just completed a series of nationwide performances. This week, however, he's back on his usual pitch outside Bradford and Bingley. Right. I'd like you, please, Graham, to start, and the song is When the Red, Red Robin Comes Bob, Bob, Bobbing Along.
When the red scarlet robin comes bob, shilling, bobbing along, ditto, there'll be no more sobbing.
Challenge from Willie.
Ditto isn't very good, you know.
What's wrong with it?
It just doesn't mean along.
I agree with Willie on this one.
Well, I don't. Carry on, Graham.
And where does Robert Robinson come into it anyway?
Sobbing when he starts throbbing his old sweet song. Wake up, ditto, you sleepyhead.
Challenge from Tim.
A repetition of ditto.
We have had ditto previously.
You pick up the song, Tim.
Where from?
Get up, get out of bed.
Who else do you?
Get up, rise, leap off your couch, cheer up, smile for God's sake, the sun is red, live, love, laugh and be happy. What if I've been blue, now I'm walking through, feel
off your... We've got miles and go now.
In the glint of us, still I listen for hours and minutes. I'm just kind of doing what I did again, singing a song, when the red crimson... Sparrow comes.
Oh, that's it. Bob, boom, Robert Babby. Robinson along.
That's all right. Challenge from Barry.
Hello. Sparrow is not synonymous with Robin.
Better than Titto.
That was fun. That's almost all we've got time for, though. There's just enough time for a round of Undertaker's Songbook. So, teams, while Samantha slips out into the audience to check for signs of life, I'd like you please to suggest some song titles or first lines likely to be popular with an audience of undertakers.
Okay. Champion the Wonder Hearse.
Okay, you start, Barry.
He always said he'd be late for his own funeral.
Ditto. Wop bap a lup a lap a lum embalm.
Ah, that's like... Some embalming evening, you may stuff a stranger.
You're the cream in my coffin?
I'm getting buried in the morning.
Oh, she wore an itsy bitsy teeny weeny yellow polka dot winding sheet.
top hat and nails.
Oh, dear.
I dig it my way.
Tie a yellow ribbon round the cemetery.
I can't get no putrefaction by the roll.
The old Engelbert, please deep freeze me.
Well, you're just my Jack in a box.
Where have all the flowers gone?
Well, ladies and gentlemen, as the Rock of Ages is cleft in twain by the karate chop of fate, I notice it has Souvenir of Watford written all the way through it. Probably means the time's come to say goodbye. So from Samantha, the teams, and myself, goodbye.
Timbrook Taylor, Barry Trier, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given Silly Things to Do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith. Present I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. Once more, we're coming to you from the glorious, historic city of Watford, forever associated with glamour, high finance, style and the international jet set, as summed up in the city's favourite son, Nick Leeson. Once again, we have with us our regular teams, and what can I say about them that hasn't been said before? They're four of the brightest, wittiest and most original comic talents in the business. And that's just a few things that have never been said about them. Anyway, they are on my right. Willie Rushton and Timbrook Taylor. And on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. And if that were not excitement enough, please welcome, taking things down with her usual gusto, the very delightful Samantha. First round is entitled Historical Headlines. In the olden days, teams, before newspapers were invented, the great news events of the day went largely unreported. The only news came from someone called a town crier, who I understand went into the market square and shouted out the main news stories before putting an enormous wooden checkerboard on his back so people could do the crossword. In this round, teams, I'd like you please to come up with some likely newspaper headlines that one might have found in the morning papers after a certain historical event. And the event is the French Revolution. And Barry, since you're the nearest thing we have to a local crier, will you start, please?
Hello, magazine. Our marriage will last forever, says Louis the 16th.
Graham.
In the Sun, spot the Pimpernel and win a Metro.
Willie?
The Independent has a headline here. Leaders of French Revolution promise liberty, equality, fraternity, free beer and dirty postcards to Sarah Bernhardt.
Tim?
Well, the Guardian has got liberty, equality and ostrich. The Times, in its old understated way, aristocracy most affected by cuts.
In similar vein, Financial Times, guillotine shares go through the roof. Aristo PLC take a tumbril.
Woman's Own, exclusive Madame Lafarge knitting pattern.
Good, well, let's try another. This time it's Julius Caesar's invasion of Britain. And Graham, would you start this time, please?
Yep, the Sun, Veni, Vidi, Gotcha.
The Guardian quotes Julius Caesar, Veni, Vidi, Ostrich.
British Medical Journal, Roman Army doctors set up Veni, Vici, Vidi clinic.
Melody Maker, Veni, Vidi, Fiki, Mick and Titch go to number one.
And the Colchester Echo, Tesco sells out of pizzas.
Financial Times, FT Index up 423 points on expectation of huge road building scheme.
Daily Express, Romans invade, no Britons involved.
Any more? Okay, well, it's time now for a popular round called Pick Up Song. As is customary in this game, my special gramophone will be operated by Samantha, who's pulled out a selection of old 7 inches to spin for your delight. I'd like your teams to sing along until, at my signal, Samantha will sharply twist the knob in an anti-clockwise motion, causing the music to drop out. If on its return, teams, you're within a gnat's crotchet of the original, I'll be awarding points, and points mean prizes. What do points mean? Prizes! You've just heard one of several reasons why they've sealed off the centre of Watford with an an impenetrable ring road. This week's prize, incidentally, is just the thing for the busy cross-dresser who's always on the move. This lovely portable TV set. Right, Tim, you're going to start. I'd like you to accompany Manhattan Transfer singing Java Jive.
I love coffee. I love tea. I love the Java Jive and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Java and me. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup. Oh. I love Java, sweet and hot. Whoops, Mr. Motor, I'm a coffee pot. Shoot me the pot and it'll pull me a shot. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup. From that wonderful mug, I got a rug till I'm snug in the jug. A slice of onion and a raw one. Draw one. Waiter, waiter.
Coffee.
Enormous gnat.
Willie, would you please accompany Muriel Smith singing Happy Talk from the musical South Pacific?
Happy talking, happy talk. Talk about the things you like to do. You got to have a dream. If you don't have a dream, how you gonna have a dream come true? Talk about floating in the sky, looking like a lily on a lake. Talk about a bird learning how to fly, making all the music how he can make.
Oh!
Very slow, Muriel.
Well, you were moving in on it.
Oh.
Graham, will you accompany Engelbert Humperdinck singing Release Me?
Please release me.
our lives would be a sin. Release me and let me love again. Oh, I have found a new love, dear. And I will always want her near.
Always.
Barry, I think it's fair to say you've got all to play for. You're going to accompany the big bopper singing Chantilly Lace.
Chantilly lace and a pretty face and a ponytail hanging down, a wiggle in a walk and a giggle in a talk. Make the world go round. Ain't nothing in the world like a big-eyed girl to make me act so funny, make me spend my money.
You
feel real loose like a long neck, loose like a girl. Oh, baby, that's what I like.
What's that, baby?
Our next round is a new one in which, ladies and gentlemen, we must enter the strange twilight world of the supernatural. It's called Mystic Humph. And in it, I shall be revealing my secrets for winning the national lottery before asking the teams to reveal theirs. Listeners at home should at this point place their hands on their radios, please, in order to feel the warmth of my mental powers. Stop that, Samantha. Right, teams, I must ask you now to hum while I give my predictions. Yes. Yes. Yes, it's becoming clearer now. You can make a bundle of money out of the lottery by being the grandson of a famous prime minister and flogging state papers back to the nation. Okay, teams, you can stop humming now. Tim, what's your mystic tip for winning the lottery, please?
4, 19, 23, 37, and 48 are one short of the numbers you require for this.
Barry, your tip for winning the lottery?
Well, I hope it works for me. I've been pursuing it for some time, which is to combine my inside leg measurement with my phone number. But the downside is people keep ringing my inside leg. So, which can be pleasant, but...
Willie.
Well, this isn't giving anything away, really. But if you write down any six numbers and one spare, that's seven numbers, and if you work on the law of average that none of those seven numbers will come up as usual, you can then cross them out. It's extremely unlikely the next seven numbers you write down are going to come up, so you cross them out. This is exercise you carry out until you've got 42 numbers. Then you just put down the last seven and you're in with a faint chance.
Graham.
Yes, well, Tim was one number short there, and I think I'm getting something coming through. The extra number. I'm getting a name. Somebody here. Anyone called Foskett? Forsyth? Fordyce? Hamilton? We've got a Smith here. Well, I mentioned six names and none of them are here. So six is the number that will come up.
I shall remember that.
Spooky.
The next round is called Connections, and in it I'd like the teams to identify the connections linking various people or things. For example, if I were to list the names Jack Charlton, Bobby Charlton, Suzanne Charlton, and Charlton Heston, you would, I hope, immediately spot the obvious connection. None of them have ever played for West Bromwich Albion. Tim,
I'd like you to start, please, by telling me the connection between, and these are all genuine connections, in a box of false eyeballs, an artificial leg, and a bottle of bull semen. I'll say that again.
I love it when you talk dirty, Hunt. Something that happened in the war, was it?
In a bottle of bull semen.
This is the first aid kit of the South African rugby team. And obviously something that happened to you in the war as well.
Actually, the right answer, and it did happen to me during the war, by an odd coincidence, they've all been handed in to the London Transport Lost Property Office. Willie, your turn. Can you please connect Coca-Cola, Pledge and Nova?
Well, they're all jolly useful standbys if you can't get onto Dino Rod. Little household hint for anybody here whose drains are plugged. Is that right?
No, it's not.
Oh.
Anybody know?
No.
Well, they're all product names with unfortunate meanings in other countries. In China, the literal translation of the word Coca-Cola means bite the wax, tadpole.
How often would you say that?
I'm saying it all the time in wartime, I tell you. In Holland, pledge means urine. And the people of Spain were reluctant to buy Nova cars, since in Spanish, Nova means doesn't go. Graham, what's the connection between Coco Chanel, or Chanel, I should say. My French is getting worse and worse. Oh. Herbert Hoover, Boris Karloff, and the Prophet Muhammad.
Yeah, tread carefully here, I think. Well, the mountain didn't come to any of them. I think the answer is that they all gave their names to products. Coco Chanel, the popular bedtime drink. And Herbert Hoover, of course, invented the Herbert Dab. And I think I'm right in saying that Boris Karloff's real name was Lillette. But if you think I'm going to risk a fatwa by going any further...
Well, it's rather boring answer. They were all orphans. And Barry, can you spot the connection between Alexander Graham Bell, Thomas Edison, and Agatha Christie?
Oh, I read this. I read this in Rubber News. Which I get for the gardening hints.
Bed wetting the hard way.
Alexander Graham Bell and Thomas Edison both made obscene phone calls to Agatha Christie. Just a shot in the dark.
Well, the interesting thing is they were all educated at home.
Who's
been jolly crowded for you, haven't
they?
Was it during the war? These are back to you.
Right, now it's time to play the game called Mornington Crescent. Before we do, I noticed that we've been inundated with a card from a Mrs. Trellis. Who writes in her capacity as Secretary of the North Wales Chapter of the Mornington Crescent Psychic Insomniacs Trust. She writes, Dear Mr. Littleton. Dear Mr. Littleton, I know what you're thinking. Many heartfelt thanks to you and the teams for all the help you've given in finding a surefire cure for our members, many of whom hadn't slept a wink in years until discovering your program. P.S. It was so nice to hear you again next year. Well, glad to be of assistance, Mrs. Trellis. Anyway, back to the game. And this week we'll be playing Thornton's controversial Third Amendment.
Thornton's.
So, teams, you should be alert to the obvious trap when cross-hatching. Oh, and all stations can now be trumped, even out of kilter. Right, who's going to start? What about you, Graham?
Stations, right. Euston Road.
Paddington Place.
Clarendon Road.
Earl's Court Road.
Yes.
It's not out of kilter, is it?
No.
Earl's Court.
No.
Completely done me.
Remember, Thornton.
That's true. But is it out of kilter?
Yeah. Well, it's worth trying.
Euston Road.
I mean, it's not out of kilter.
Humph may not know.
Humph knows everything.
Oh.
So what's your move going to be?
I've forgotten now.
Well, you better think.
I said Euston Road.
Yes. Wasn't a very good move. Well, it was a
kilter-ish. But a cross-hatching there.
Did cross-hatching, yes.
Well, I don't think Thornton would approve of that. Adjudication, please, Hum.
Why? I mean, you haven't made a challenge yet.
What?
You haven't contested it, so I can't adjudicate.
Well, yes, the challenge was, some time ago, that it wasn't out of kilter.
But it isn't out of kilter.
So the challenge was correct, then?
But he didn't trump it, did he?
The whole point was that it shouldn't be out of kilter.
But you didn't trump it?
No. But it was cross.
Leave that to you, Hum.
I mean, the rule clearly says you can trump it, even if it's out of kilter. You don't have to trump it, and you didn't.
Yeah, right.
Provided there's no cross-hatching, Humphrey. There's the rub.
There wasn't any cross-hatching. I thought we'd establish that.
Yeah. Get on with it, Barry.
Come on, Barry.
St. Bosch's Barry.
Vicarage Road.
Yep. He's a low and dirty player.
I'm playing nearly at home, that's why.
But I shall make a mockery of his move. God, it's going to be good. Deeds Crescent.
King Street.
Mornington Crescent.
Oh. Yes.
Trump.
Excellent. That was actually quite a good round. Now it's time for a round of limericks, the simple rhyme scheme that was, as you'd expect, originally devised in the Irish town of Cork. Teams, I must ask each of you to put on your dancing pumps and, as the Pope says to young mothers, get some rhythm. Because this week's theme is American soul musicians. I shall now furnish you, teams, each with a fecund first line, which I'd like you to continue taking one line each of.
And we do the fecund line, do we?
That was the wartime pronunciation. Willie, we're going to start with you. In Tesco's with earth, wind and fire.
In Tesco's with earth, wind and fire. Mr. Wind assaulted a buyer.
Mr. Fire then hit earth.
Who promptly gave birth.
Tesco's, news at 10, Barry Cryer.
Graham, your first line is, my hamster is called Otis Redding.
My hamster is called Otis Redding. My goldfish is Joan Armour Treading.
My dogs are the platters.
Not that that matters.
No, we're all up to here with the wedding.
Tim, I'm sorry about the scansion of this, but...
That's okay, Hump.
The artist formerly known as Prince.
The artist formerly known as Prince. On the stage, he would posture and mint.
Then just for a giggle...
Change his name to a squiggle.
And nobody's heard of him since.
Finally, Barry, here's one for you. When it snows, you will find Sister Sledge.
Out mooning. at night on the ledge.
Out mooning at night on a ledge. One story down.
Is the maestro, James Brown.
Displaying his meat and two veg.
Right, well, now we have a musical round called Wurzels, in tribute to a madcap group of men who really put the county of Somerset on the map. The Ordnance Survey Land Registry Department. In this round, teams, I'll be asking you to sing certain songs of my choosing, but in the aggregate...
Bit of shrapnel coming up, is it?
In this round, teams, I'll be asking you to sing certain songs of my choosing, but in the agriculturally inspired West Country style of the Wurzels. Even though this is a musical round, you'll be accompanied at the piano by Colin Sell. Incidentally, regarding the certain fame which Colin Sell enjoyed as a young man, I've been supplied with an old cutting from Colin's local paper about his first record. It reads, Colin Sell went straight in at number 4. Magistrates gave him 6 months up. After hearing he lived at number 28. Right, Barry and Graham, you're to start, and your song is the delightful You Are My Lucky Star. Now, your turn, Tim and Willie, and your song is You Made Me Love You.
He made I love me. I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to do it. He made I want he. And all the time he knew it. Oh, I guess I always knew it.
Bless
he made I happy sometimes. Oh, he made I mad. Every time he's here, he made I feel so bad. I didn't want to tell you, I didn't want to tell you. I want some scrumpy trip with New York. I try for, he knows I'm the brand I try for, he knows I made me.
Come by now, mister.
They do say that all good things must come to an end, which means that we've still got plenty more rounds to endure. Anyway, there's still time to play a swift round of Train Drivers Film Club. So while Samantha nips out to blow the station master's whistle for him, I'd like you teams to suggest some titles of films likely to be popular with an audience of train drivers and other railway staff. And Willie, we'll start with you.
A Close Encounter in the Third Class.
4 sidings in a Eurotunnel.
The Wrong Sort of Snow White and the 7 Dwarfs.
Purple Train, starring Signal, formerly known as Points.
Sidings of the Lambs.
King Solomon's Mind the Doors, Please.
The Odd Coupling.
Never on a Sunday.
Thank you. The French as Lieutenant's Woman.
Cheap Day Return of the Jedi.
The Line in Winter. Closed due to Leif Erikson on the line.
as the frisky tomcat of fate confronts the scalpel of destiny. And the precious natural woodland of time meets the motorway extension of eternity. I see that our time is up. So from the team, Samantha, myself, and the fine people of Watford, goodbye.
Tim Roper, Barry Cryer, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given silly things to do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith. Presents I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello. Hello and welcome to I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. Today we're coming to you from the brand new Radio Theatre in Broadcasting House, a splendidly appointed venue which the BBC hopes will become a mecca for lovers of great entertainment. And it shouldn't be long before our teams tonight have quite a number of them on their knees. The teams are, on my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke-Taylor. And on my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. Well, sadly, our regular scorer, Samantha, is away promoting her interactive virtual reality exercise video. It's called Virtually Doing It with Samantha. Please welcome her replacement from downtown Stockholm, a man who's got muscles where most of us have got shrimps. Our own Scandinavian Superman, the delightful Sven. Our first round is entitled Celebrity Misquotes. In it, teams, I'd like you to suggest wildly exaggerated quotations which the rich and famous would never have said. It's based on an interesting diversion that's commercially available under the title Daily Newspapers. So, teams, I'm after remarks that famous people alive or dead would never have said. And Barry, will you start, please?
Jane Austen, I usually write the sex bits first.
Henri de Toulouse-Lautrec, the high balls are on me.
Margaret Thatcher, I really hope John is voted back in.
Pete Sampras, it's the British players that worry me.
Jonathan Lomu, excuse me, would you mind if I came through?
Florence Nightingale, what do we want? A rise. When do we want it? Now.
Henry VIII, whatever you say, my dear.
Mine's a baby sham, Rasputin.
Linda McCartney, yum yum, jugged hair.
Any advance on that?
Geoffrey Archer. Look, in all honesty.
Okay, well, let's go on to our second round now. It's called One Song to the Tune of Another. And as ever with these cryptic titles, it'll need some detailed explanation. What I've done, teams, is to make two selections of songs. The first will be played without the words or lyrics, leaving just the backing accompaniment or music. The second selection will also have the words or lyrics, but they'll be separated from the music or backing track. Then, and here comes the clever part, what happens next is that the remainder libretto part of the first selection will be matched with the residual tunes of the second list in a way that puts different backing tracks with contrasting words that weren't originally intended to match. And if you thought that was hard to follow, just wait until you hear Colin Sell's piano accompaniment. Right, Tim, you're going to start, and I'd like you to sing the words of Kiss by the artist formerly known as Prince.
to the tune of Don't Cry for Me, Argentina.
You don't have to be beautiful to turn me on. I just need your body, baby, from dusk till dawn. You don't need experience to turn me out. You just leave it all up to me. I'll show what it's all about. You don't have to be rich to be my girl. You don't have to be cool to rule my world. Ain't no peculiar sign I'm more compatible with. I just want your extra time and your kiss. You gotta not talk dirty, baby, if you wanna impress me. You can't be too flirty, mama. I know how to undress me.
Okay, your turn, Willie, and I'd like you to sing the words of Chanson d'Amour to the tune of Danny Boy.
Chanson d'Amour, da-da-da-da, play on four. Here in my heart, da-da-da-da, da-da-da, more and more. Chanson d'Amour, da-da-da. Just adore. Each time I hear ra-da-da-da, chanson d'amour, chanson d'amour, chanson d'amour, chanson d'amour, chanson d'amour.
Have another glass of gay Guinness.
Oh, ra-da-da-da-da-da-da.
Larry, over the top.
Okay, it's you now, Barry. I'd like you, please. Well, I say I'd like you. I'm paid to ask you, please. To sing the words of the Flanders and Swans song, I'm a Gnu, to the tune of Send in the Clowns.
The nicest work of good nature in the zoo. I'm a gnu. How do you do? Really ought to know who's a wahoo. I'm a gnu, spelled G-N-U.
Right, and finally, Graham, would you please sing the words of My Favorite Things to the tune of Minnie the Moocher?
Raindrops on roses and whiskers on kittens. Bright copper kettles, warm woolen mittens. Brown paper packages tied up with strings. These are a few of my favorite things. Cream-colored ponies. Crisp apple strudels.
Crisp apple strudels.
Doorbells and sleigh bells.
Doorbells and sleigh bells.
And schnitzel with noodles.
Schnitzel with noodles.
Our next round is entitled Call My Bluff, and its rules are identical to the 1970s television program of the same name. For purposes of authenticity, then, teams, I shall adopt the persona of Robert Robinson. Willie, you can be Frank Muir.
Thank you.
Graham, Arthur Marshall. Barry, you can be Miles Kington. And Tim, I see you very much as the young Joanna Lumley. Well, teams, as you would expect, I shall provide you with an obscure word, and I'd like you to provide me with some definitions for it. The word is... chrysanthemum. And we'll start with you, Tim.
During the Crusades, if you'll come back with me to the Crusades, even round at the pub would be due. There was a short time when there was an arms embargo on both sides. Instead of swords and armour and the like, the forces were left with a war of words, or rather words and music. Those from the East employed a particularly effective sort of creepy wail, where the Christian militia tried singing Western church music at the tops of their voices. In order to gauge the effectiveness of their noise, Brother Wayne of Shepton Mallet invented a splendid little gadget, and the name of this device was a chrysanthermometer, or to give it its full title, the Christian Anthem Thermometer. Now, it's usually abbreviated to chrysanthemum, and a similar device is used in Wimbledon today to measure the volume of the rather unattractive grunts of the professional lady tennis players.
Okay. Barry, will you give me your definition, please?
Well, very credible, but it's not true. I live in a little place called Hatch End in Middlesex, which has three women to every man. The same three women. And but our proudest daughter is Mrs. Beaton. This is absolutely true. Was born, not born, no, lived in Hatch End most of her life. Died at the age of 29, cremated on a load of gas. But she was a friend, as am I, of our local vicar. And he would often come around for tea, and she was known for her sandwiches, named, as you know, after Lord Cardigan. And she had very strong thumbs because she'd been and was throughout her life a potter. Strong thumbs are essential for that. And her party piece was, in fact, to press her thumbs while balancing a pint of beer on her head. She was a Beatrix Potter. But the strong thumbs are crucial and germane to this. Her speciality were cress sandwiches, but she would press them with her thumbs, enabling the bread to absorb the moisture from the cress. And these were the vicar's favourites. And it's in her book, if you look, in Mrs. Beaton's cookbook, Cress and Thummum. A hint from Mrs. Beaton.
Willie?
There's a club in Pall Mall. There's an old club called the Athenaeum, which is the sort of upper class version of care in the community. Lunatic old bishops and lords go to die, basically, because they can lie there for some days before anybody notices, and it's quite useful. It's quite nice for them. And this is where Christian comes in. It's Christian Athenaeum, basically, which used to be the telex address for the Archbishop of Canterbury. Christian Athenaeum.
Graham.
This'll interest you, Hump.
Okay, it won't.
Don't forget your toothbrush. Didn't become a triumphant success by accident, in spite of appearances. It was actually based on a clip of home movie filmed many years ago on Super 8. In fact, so long ago it was on Quite Good 8. This little bit of movie showed the infant Chris Evans on his way to bed, and his mother reminds him, "Don't forget your toothbrush." And the wee toddler replies, "I'd rather go to Barbados." And so a legend was born, and that clip of film is revered in television circles today, where it's known as Chris and the Mum.
Well, I'm supposed to decide which I think is the true one. Tim's... I wasn't really paying much attention to you.
You weren't alone.
I think it's yours, Willie.
Thank you.
Now, can we see who's bluffing and who's telling the truth? Right, our next round is... For our next round, we were to be playing a game called Name That Tune. In it, Colin Sell plays a tune and then tries to recognize it as quickly as possible. However, as the fastest time in rehearsals was 2.5 hours, we're going to play an earlier version of the game called Name Those Roadworks. Teams, I shall shortly play in a sound recording of some well-known roadworks, which I'd like you please to identify. All right, well, here they come now. Right. Well, what do you think about that, Barry?
The drills gave it away. It's the...
There's somebody working there.
It's the... I passed there and took a photograph. It's the 312 Harrow. A312.
I'm sorry, no.
No?
No. No.
I think it's the A40. Just west of the Westway. About Bristol.
No, I'm sorry, you haven't got it either.
Oh.
Is Chippenham anything to do with this?
What, those big muscular brutes who come on the telly?
Think back. It's
Watling Street.
Mornington Crescent.
You're not going to get it. It was, of course, an old favourite. Resurfacing work on the A5 north of Shrewsbury.
Shrewsbury.
I think possibly the interference from the temporary traffic lights on the nearby A458 must have put you off. Well, I enjoyed that so much, I think we'll have a quick... we'll have a quick round of Name That Pause. I'm going to play in three pauses that you should recognise from recent radio output. Can you identify them, please? Here they come now.
I've got that one.
We've all got that one.
Yes.
How do you know it's finished?
That one. That
and the third one coming up now.
Oh.
Okay, now.
Yes. Well, the second one, Humph, the second one was the pause between Anderson Country and another bloody stupid idea.
I'm going to give you 15 marks for that. And to hell with Sven.
Well, the third one was that middle bit out of T for Two Cha Cha Cha.
No.
Was one of them Terry Christian trying to think of a question?
No, I'll tell you what. I'll have to tell you. You should have really have recognized the first one from its many appearances in Letter from America. The second one was the Radio 1 listener spot. And the one that Willie got, he actually got the wrong pause there that's actually been preserved for posterity under the title The Best of Anderson Country. Now, it's time to immerse ourselves in a round called Sounds Peculiar, which I understand was an original suggestion for the title of this program. A less original one was Sounds Rubbish. Right, teams, I shall play for you some unusual sound effects which I'd like you please to identify. And Tim, the first one's for you, and here it is now.
This sounds like something sponsored by Heinz. The 57 varieties fame. Sponsored meeting. It probably leads me to believe that this was a huge vote of confidence in Will Carling by the 57 officers of the English Rugby Union.
Barry, see if you can identify this.
Elizabeth Hurley trying to act her way out of a paper bag. Or Jane Russell.
Willie, can you tell me what this is?
Aznap éjjel nem kellett tartani az égtől. A víz volt Heródes bűnsegédje a sötétben.
Pár óra múlva szinte 5 percenként szakították meg az adást annak közlésével.
That's slapping hands on naked stomach. That's Desmond Morris translating the Kama Sutra from the original Hungarian into body language for Zsa Zsa Gabor.
Finally, Graham, I'd like you please to identify this.
Hello,
I think that was a blazing oil well being put out by Red Adair and Ginger Rogers.
Well, that was fun now. This is a round called Notes and Queries. Whiling away an idle moment with my copy of The Guardian, I happened upon an interesting question and answer section, which they call Tones and Queasy. In it, correspondents pose questions and supply answers to such problems as, has there ever been a newspaper format where readers do all the work for nothing? And has the idea ever been blatantly ripped off for use in a wireless program? Well, we shouldn't get too bogged down with such hypothetical questions. Here instead, teams, are a number of genuine queries for which I'd like you please to supply the answers. And we'll start with you, Barry. And the query is, how much is the Pope paid?
Ah, now, I know. He's not paid in money. He's paid in wine. That's why they have to carry him about in that chair.
Well, actually, you're very, very close, because the answer is that theoretically, he's paid nothing at all. All his expenses are met by a specific Vatican department. On with the fun. Graham. Your question is, why is no food blue? I'll say that again. I felt a bit sick while I was saying it. Why is no food blue?
Well, it is if you leave it long enough.
Well, the answer is... this is interesting. Because there are exceptions, of course, which you might have mentioned. You'd have got an extra mark or two for that. I'm sure Sven would have accommodated you. There are exceptions.
Well,
such as blueberries and blue cheese.
Yeah.
But the answer generally seems to be that most plant foods are mildly acidic when fresh. And blue is primarily an alkaline colour.
Gosh.
Oh, no.
Willie, can you tell me, please, where is it not regarded as impolite or shameful to break wind in public?
From past experience, I'd say the seat next to me.
After all these years, now you tell me.
Well, I'll tell you, in the Pirapirana area of northwest Amazon, and possibly France... Personally, I wouldn't risk it myself.
They call it the Mistral.
Tim, a question for you. Question for you, Tim.
Yes, I'm.
Who invented the deck chair?
The Marquis de Sade.
It goes back a bit further than that. It was probably the ancient Egyptians, since similar folding X-type chairs have been discovered in their tombs. Then again, it probably wasn't.
Could be the French.
Yeah, probably.
All that blowing
over. Possibly windbreaks.
Our next round's entitled Blues. The other day, listeners, Willie came up to me and said, "Humph, why are we always pandering to the public's tinkling, superficial laughter? I want a round that shows the anxiety of the 20th century man. I want a round that lets me express the deep hurt of my inner child." So with this in mind, teams, I'd like you to provide...
I said that.
You did. Teams, I'd like you to provide each other with a subject on which to sing a melancholy blues number. It's bound to be a close-fought round, as I know you're all exceptionally sad individuals. And just to complete the depression, the piano accompaniment will be provided by Colin Sell. Right, Tim and Willie, I'm going to ask you, please, to provide a suitable subject for Barry and Graham.
The Hello Magazine Blues. Oh,
thank you.
It's all right.
Woke up this morning. Day began. Looked in Hello Magazine. Saw another happy man. Now I've heard that Michael Jackson can't do it, but we know that Imran can. Oh, he's dirty man. He has the capability.
Well done, Colin. Barry and Graham, will you please suggest a title for Tim and Willie?
Oh, I think The Lottery.
The Lottery.
The Lottery.
They read out my lottery numbers. 2, 9, 15, 37, 41, and 42. Oh, yeah, they did. They really did.
They say that money don't bring happiness. So I can spend the rest of my life singing the lowdown. Miserable ain't life a pain. Oh, my God, I'm suffering. Who needs 20 million quid anyway? Blues! Oh, oh yeah!
Well, as Sven and his personal trainer, Bjorn, pop off together to the BBC gymnasium, before I pop off too to watch them getting down to action on the pec deck, I'd like you please to announce the late arrivals at the ornithologist ball.
From Australia, will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Platypus and their duck, William?
There, if you look for it.
Only welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Tit. And their son, Tom.
Mr. and Mrs. Can and their footballing son, Pele. Separate bills, please.
From Wales, the family Mott, with their mining son, Black Gwilly.
Will you welcome, please, Geoffrey Archer? I mention him because he usually gets a laugh and he's undeniably a tit. And a great bearded tit is the Oliver Reed Warbler.
Mr. and Mrs. Shag. And their children are far too numerous to mention.
And from Ireland, Mr. and Mrs. O'Warbler and their son Will O'Warbler.
Mr. and Mrs. Earns.
Oh, welcome.
And their none too generously endowed son, Little Bit.
From Spain, senor and senora, pretty boy then. And their son, Jose, pretty boy.
Well, Mr. and Mrs., will you welcome, please, Mr. and Mrs. Tross and their peripatetic son, Albert, the wandering albatross.
And bad news for the grouse, here comes Gloria Stwelfth.
And the North of Scotland, will you welcome, please, and he's not happy, in fact, he's having a bit of a grouse, it's Sir Peregrine Falcon and his gilly, Mott.
And also...
He's puffing a bit.
Sorry.
From
that part of the world.
Uh-huh.
Mr. and Mrs. Doting to Slimbridge. And their little son, Wee Ken, Doting to Slimbridge.
From Germany, will you welcome, please, the Ingalls? That's Frau and Herringel.
Mr. and Mrs. Redbreast and their son, Arthur.
And so, ladies and gentlemen, as the privatized utility of time meets the Nolan Inquiry of eternity, and the Rob Andrew of life meets the Jonah Lomu of destiny, I notice that it's all over. Tune in again in 2 weeks from today and you'll miss the final edition of this series, which is taking place next week. Meantime, from the teams, Sven, Bjorn and myself, goodbye.
Tim Brooke-Taylor, Barry Trier, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given Silly Things to Do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith. Presents I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue, the antidote to panel games. At the piano is Colin Sell, and your chairman is Humphrey Littleton.
Hello, hello and welcome to another fun-packed, laughter-enriched, hormone-injected edition of I'm Sorry I Haven't a Clue. Once more, we're coming to you from the BBC's new radio theatre in the very bowels of Broadcasting House. This splendid auditorium dates back to the 1930s and has been sympathetically refurbished to replicate its authentic Art Deco style. To preserve what was on offer to audiences in that bygone age, great efforts have been made to seek out and display precious original relics that have inexplicably survived to modern times. On my left, Barry Cryer and Graham Garden. On my right, Willie Rushton and Tim Brooke Taylor. And I regret to report that once more we're without our regular scorer, Samantha, who's written to tell me that she's run off to join the circus. She says there's very little glamorous about it, just long hours of hard work, then off to bed with a steaming cocoa. So please welcome again, dressed in a brief singlet and single pair of briefs, please welcome the charming Sven. Our first round is entitled Misleading Advice. Any foreign visitor to Britain will be delighted with the warm, friendly greeting from our immigration service, the standard of helpful advice available at all British Rail ticket offices, and the remarkable value afforded by the taxi tour of London's many fascinating outer suburbs on the journey from Charing Cross to Trafalgar Square. Teams, I'd like you please to come up with some suggestions and guidelines for the first-time visitor to these shores. And Graham, will you start, please?
Yes, don't miss Wimbledon fortnight, but get there early to book the court.
Our traffic wardens are usually addressed as Titface.
Willie.
Should you chance upon Germaine Greer during your travels, ask her how a hysterectomy went.
For our American visitors, some reassuring advice about water. There are some very good spas in England with wonderful water. Buxton, my own hometown, Malvern, and of course Bath. The best thing to say to your waitress is, I'd very much like to drink your bath water.
On that score, the English for lavatory is Pizza Hut.
Please do not consult your maps in the middle of the pavement. Zebra crossings are provided for this purpose.
What better guide to the lifestyle of a typical Englishman than an innovations catalogue?
Any more? Right, our next round is an old musical favourite called Pick Up Song. In it, I'd like you please to sing along to some records of my choosing. While MC rap master hip-hop DJ Soul King Sven skillfully manipulates the volume by adjusting the knob on his reproduction equipment. In other words, the music will at a random point drop out. If upon its return, teams, you're within a hair's crotchet of the original, I'll be awarding points, and points mean prizes. What do points mean? I thought all this money spent on this building would attract a better class of person. This week's prize, incidentally, is just the thing to snuggle up with on a romantic weekend in the country. It's this genuine sheepskin sheep. Right, teams, well, today I've got some duets for you. You're first, Tim and Willie, and I'd like you to accompany Bing Crosby and Frank Sinatra singing Well Did You Ever from High Society.
I have heard among this clan you are called a forgotten man.
Is that what they're saying?
Well, did you ever?
What a swell party this is.
And have you heard the story of a boy, a girl, unrequited love?
Sound like your soap opera?
I cry,
tune in tomorrow. What a swell party this is. What frails, what frocks.
What broads.
What furs, what rocks.
They're beautiful.
I've never seen such gaiety.
Neither have I.
It's all just tutu excu, really.
This French champagne.
Domestic.
So good for the brain.
That's what I was going to say.
You're a brilliant fellow.
Thank you.
Drink up, Jack. And please don't eat that glass, my friend. Have you heard about dear Blanche? Got run down by an avalanche.
No.
Got run down by an avalanche.
I suppose at our age, you're bound to be a bit quicker than them.
Okay, Graham and Barry, I'd like you please to accompany Ray Middleton and Ethel Merman singing Anything You Can Do from Annie Get Your Gun.
You be
and now, little lady, if you'll kindly step up to the parapet, I'll give you a lesson in marksmanship.
You can give me a lesson in long-distance shooting. Anything you can do, I can do better. I can do anything better than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
Anything you can be, I can be greater. Sooner or later, I'm greater than you.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am. Yes, I am. I can shoot a partridge with a single cartridge.
Yeah, I can get the sparrow with the bow and arrow.
I can live on bread and cheese.
And only on that?
Yes.
So can a rat.
Any note you can reach, I can go higher.
I can sing anything higher than you.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Yes, I can. Yes, I can.
What?
Now, it's come to my notice that here in the new radio theatre, hidden from view, there's a magnificent organ. Much against my will, I've been instructed to ask Colin Sell to accompany the famous organist Carl Richter playing Bach's Toccata and Fugue in D minor. Well, I know I've said unkind things about Colin in the past, but I've got to admit it, that was quite good. It's time now to play a round of sound charades. In this round, the team should take it in turn to act out the title of a well-known book, film, play, TV or radio program for the other to guess. The only difference is that in our version, team members have permitted the use of their mouths. And Tim and Willie, you're to start now, and your title will be displayed via the CD-ROM magic of our digitally enhanced satellite-linked laser display board, paid for by the BBC. And for listeners at home... for listeners at home, here's the mystery voice.
Crazy for you. Crazy for you.
It's, shall I go ahead, Humph?
Yeah, go ahead.
It's three words. It's definitely a stage musical, and we're going to do it all in one. I'm in the mood for love.
Meh.
Simply because you're near me.
Meh.
It's not the amazing Little Technicolor Dream Goat, is it?
Let me remind the audience that if the teams are getting warm, you can applaud and help them.
I'm warm. Thank you. I'm boiling. This is a good game, Humph. I like this.
Listen, hurry along, please. I've got a gig in Hull on Thursday.
little sheep of horrors is four words, isn't it? You.
Yes.
Oh, crazy for you.
Oh. Here's another title going up on the laser display for you, Barry and Graham, and here's the mystery voice for listeners at home.
Flashdance. Flashdance.
Okay. Now, is that a book, a play, or a what?
It's a film.
Oh.
Two
what?
Words.
How many words?
Oh, yes, that's right. No, arguably one word.
Have you started yet, or what is
it? No, this isn't part of it. Did the audience think it's one word? What would you say?
Call it
one
word for the sake of confusion.
Is it a film?
It's a film, yes.
It's a film, yes.
Arguably one word.
Yes.
How do you spell arguably? I'm writing it. Arguably one word.
If it wasn't one word, what would it be?
Two words.
If there's anyone from Hull listening, I'm not going to make it.
Why would anyone in Hull be interested in whether you're going to make it or not?
Come on, Barry and Graham, please.
Right, it's a film, one or two words, possibly three.
Right, you start. Go on.
Well, he was coming down the street.
No, what happened?
He was coming in a dirty old raincoat.
A dirty old raincoat? He had his Mac on, did he?
Yeah, and you'll never guess what he did then.
Oh, Mabe, what happened
with
then?
With his
Mabe,
dirty old raincoat. He did it. He grabbed me and started doing the quick step.
Oh, no.
He did it.
No.
The quick step.
Mabel, I can't believe what you're telling me.
It's true.
In a Mac, dancing with you, Mabel?
Yes.
I cannot believe what I'm hearing.
Okay.
It is arguably one word.
Yeah.
dance something.
Anything to do with...
Oh.
Dirty dancing. I thought the Mac and the dancing would do it. Oh. Filthy dancing.
Ooh. Trouserless dancing.
Oh, I don't mind if I...
Does
dancing actually come in the title?
Not dancing.
Not dancing.
Dancing. Ah, flash dance.
Oh, that's obvious.
With the score precariously poised, we go on to the next round, which is called Hitler's Diaries. And it was inspired by that unfortunate incident when Rupert Murdoch wanted to publish the writings of a notorious dictator in the Sunday Times. He did, and we've never heard the last of her. For this round, I asked the teams in advance to unearth some extracts from the genuine diaries of famous people alive or dead, which I'd like them to read out. And the opposing team should challenge if they notice anything which might indicate the diary to be a fake. Right, Willie, you're going to start, and I understand you've managed to unearth some lost diaries of Wordsworth.
Tuesday. I woke up this morning. That's quite good. I could hear Dorothy downstairs fussing about for her dentures in the microwave. She does hate cold teeth of a morning. I opened the window. Bloody daffodils. Miles and miles of little bugs. A sea of bloody daffodils, a custard lake of daffodils. I hate bloody daffodils. I'm going to suggest Dorothy we move. Thursday, looked at property in Wandsworth. Stood on Westminster Bridge, bloody awful view. How can people live like this? At least there weren't any bloody daffodils. I like caravan parks. Earth has not anything to show more fair than a decent caravan park.
Challenge from Miss Gooder. Oh, sorry. They haven't changed this tape again. I've got all the wrong names. I've got the names of the Brain of Britain team. So was that Graham? That must have been you.
Microwave.
God, you're quick.
Yes.
I don't think they had a microwave. They might have had one in Wandsworth when they moved down. But
that's true. I was a bit suspicious about that.
Yeah.
And he spelt it wrong.
How did he spell it? Sort of paraffin lamp or something?
Yeah.
So, is it a fake?
It's a total really? Fake.
It is.
I'm sorry about that.
Right, well, it's your turn, Barry, and I gather that you've discovered the diaries of Joseph, husband of Mary. Partner of Mary, sure.
Partner, yes, indeed. Monday, Mary gone shopping. Why Christmas always comes when the fields are crowded, I'll never know. Said this to Mary, but
She was listening to a Carpenter's album. Send Donkey in for service. He's not back in time, we can hire one. I said to her, there's a screw under the saddle. Not a titter. Wednesday, set off, roads crowded, tails back, tailbacks. A319 to Nazareth exit. Stop off at Happy Easter for a snack. Thursday, arrive at hotel. Wouldn't you know it, they're full. He said, the stable annex is free, but we've got to provide our own swaddling clothes. Three wise men arrived, isn't it typical? You wait ages for a wise man and then three.
Is this a translation? Or was Joseph a sort of fairly iffy cockney?
Not a lot of people know that.
No. It's probably true then. I suppose it is true, is it, Barry?
It is. It's vouched for. It's verified. It's right. Yeah.
Incidentally, I think tailsback is probably correct.
Tailsback, yes, indeed.
Like courts martial, you know.
Yes, yes.
Yes. Jim, I gather you've come up with the Lost Diaries of Macbeth.
I have indeed. Monday, had a chat with the sisters. They're planning a new TV cooking series. Have I of newts for you. Wednesday the 14th, new glasses have arrived and are excellent. I was right, it is a dagger. Thursday the 4th, a group of actors have begged me to change my name to Lord Scottish Play. Wednesday the 9th, everyone's talking about Banquo's goat. Perhaps the glass is not as good as I thought. I can't see any goat. My new hearing aid is working well, though. Must remember to leave a note for the milkman for tomorrow and tomorrow and tomorrow. Friday the 21st, not feeling well. I think I'm di...
Graham, I understand you've unearthed the Lost Diaries of Boadicea.
I have indeed, yes. Thursday, June 6th. Bloody Romans. They've really got it in for us, I see now, what with the poll tax and closing all the casualty departments. After the last battle, we had to go all the way to St. Albans to get stitched up. Had new blades fitted to the chariot. Big Reg down the garage said now I'd have no trouble getting a parking place at Tesco's. June 7th. Now there's another Roman legion heading this way. They look a right load of prats in their little leather skirts and brushes on top of their helmets. Still, what can you expect if you get your uniforms designed by Jean-Paul Gaultier?
Challenge from Tim.
Tesco, that's the ablative. It would be Tescum or Tescar. Yeah.
What have you got to
that
say?
That was the
to
safe
that,
way to say it in those days.
Rebut it.
I rebut that. Yes, I don't agree with that at all. Tescos.
I always thought she was a woman.
Yes.
Or round the legs. She was a fairly, how shall I say,
I think it's very unfair to make fun of her voice.
That is due to testosterone. Attainable at bargain pricing.
Well, I don't know. It's time now to play the game called Mornington Crescent. First of all, I see the mail room has been overwhelmed with another letter from Mrs. Trellis of North Wales. And she writes, Dear Ned. Dear Ned, wonderful, marvellous, extraordinary, remarkable are just four of the many words on page 93 of my new thesaurus. Yours sincerely, truly, faithfully, Mrs. Trellis. P.S. How about some signed photographs? Well, thank you, Mrs. Trellis. They're very nice. Right, on with the game, teams. This week, in honour of the recently announced reopening of the Mornington Crescent Underground Station, we'll be reverting to standard deviation. Always the purest form, I think. So remember, teams, the nib holder may play advantage after a looped move, which means it's probably best to avoid fairlop altogether. OK, Tim, will you start, please?
Green Park.
Birdcage War.
West Cromwell Road.
Fairlop.
Yes. Well, that's very clever, is it?
Yes, yes.
Well, you've got away with it that time.
Well, you had...
you can!
Cheapside.
Mortimer Street.
Hangabout.
Where?
Nib holding.
Is that the hangabout gyratory system?
What? When you said Fairlop, who was holding the nib then?
No, it wasn't Graham anyway, so... All right. That was all right, I think.
Queensway.
Although, come to think of it... No, I'll allow that.
Oh, Kingsway.
Kingsbury Road.
Ah.
Thank you. An aficionado up the back.
Kingsbury.
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Fairlop. Because he's got... Yes. Think about it.
It's not playing properly.
You weren't the nib holder, were you?
No, I wasn't. Nah. No, that's the only good thing about it. I wasn't the nib holder.
Well, then you can't play advantage.
Quite.
Because the previous move was looped.
Quite.
Right. Yeah, thanks, Hump.
Thank you. Try so, again, then, Bazza.
Great Portland Street.
Oh, right. Tottenham Court Road.
Camden High Street.
Good.
Battersea Bridge Road.
Oh.
No.
I think he...
Mornington Crescent.
If it's any comfort to you, I thought he was mad then.
What did you say, Barry?
I only said Mornington Crescent.
Oh, yeah.
Battersea Bridge Road.
Come on. We were playing very bad. And a loop.
I think trying to draw attention away from the winner by babbling on like that is...
I agree.
Not terribly sporting.
Bad losers.
We're talking to you, Tim. Well, our next round is called Just a Minim, and it's a kind of homage to that hilarious program which reveals Nicholas Parsons at the very peak of his mental form. Sale of the century. Teams, I'd like you please to sing a song of my choosing without repetition, hesitation, or deviation. Those not singing may buzz to challenge. You'll be accompanied at the piano by Colin Sell. Incidentally, I've recently been sent a cutting from the Farmers' Gazette about a concert Colin gave at this year's Set Aside and Subsidy Charity Ball. It reads, Colin's piano playing was much enhanced when he had a go at singing... Oh, wait a minute. I'm sorry, that should read, when he had a goat singing as well. The song is I Want to Hold Your Hand, and Willie, I'd like you to start, please.
Oh, yeah, I'll tell you something. I think you'll understand. Then I'll say...
Are you singing with me, Willie?
I don't know the tune.
Challenge from Tim Brooke-Taylor.
Deviation from the tune.
Yes.
By the pianist. I was just talking it. Rex Harrison got away with it for years.
And actually, Colin, I don't want to be pernickety about this, but as accompanist, you're meant to play with him and not him with you. Might help if you took those headphones off and joined the real world. Okay, start again.
Oh, yeah, I think you'll understand. Then I'll say that other thing. I want to hold your hand. I desire to clutch your mitt. I would fondle your glove. And when I touch you, I feel happy inside. It's such a feeling that my love I can't hide. I can't Jekyll.
Challenge from Graham.
Jekyll, deviation.
It's not a verb.
No, quite. You can't.
Jekyll is Jekyll. Not a verb.
Barry, you can take over.
I'm incapable of self-concealment. Oh, please, say to me, you let me be your man, and I beg you, quoth in my direction, you'll allow me to grip your digits. Oh,
talent from Tim.
Repetition of ho.
I'm auditioning for Father Christmas.
I don't know. Yeah, I think I'll allow that. Although, technically speaking, ho, 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 when it applies to laughter, is really one word.
Thank you, Hub.
Yeah, you got that something I think you'll understand when I feel something. I haven't got to the something.
Two somethings.
Repetition of buzz. I'll tell you what, it's very nearly time to go, but before Sven nips out to fulfill his part-time role as junior EC fisheries officer, apparently it involves picking up Spanish fishermen and inspecting their fish nets for... it does.
Please. Please.
For irregular-sized tackle. Anyway, I'd like you teams to suggest some titles of songs likely to prove popular with the fishing community. Barry, will you start, please?
Fish Finger by Shirley Bass.
Shark, the Herald Angels Sing.
And there's a whole album of soul music sung by Pike and Tuna Turbot. Ray Charles.
Ray, oh yes.
And Little Pilchard.
Some Enchanted Evening. Stickleback Writer.
If I'd known you were coming, I'd have baked a hake.
A nice choral number, Why Are We Waiting?
Prawn Free.
Sturgeon on the corner, watching all the girls go by.
I'm leaning on a lamprey.
So,
Rod Stewart singing Maggot May.
The theme song from The Anchovy and the Ecstasy.
Girls just want to have fins. Nelly the Halibut packed her trunk.
Well, as the little white dot of eternity shrinks into the middle of the TV screen of destiny, while outside is parked the detective van of the apocalypse, I see that it's time to blame the dog for eating the license again. And to say goodbye. That's all for this series. Join us again in the autumn. In the meantime, from the teams, Sven and myself, goodbye.
Timbrook Taylor, Barry Trier, Graham Garden and Willie Rushton have been given Silly Things to Do by Humphrey Littleton, with Colin Sell setting some of them to music. The programme was produced by John Naismith.